Good evening and welcome to the STEM Academy Capstone presentation. We are so happy to have you all here to witness these students present the culmination of many months of hard work. My name is Mr. Robert Locatel, and I have had the privilege of teaching all these students and seeing them hone their skills and abilities over the last 2 years. Now, while I could wax poetic about these guys for many, many hours, this night is not about me speaking, it's about their work. So I am going to hand it over to them as soon as possible. Before that, you have a couple of people that are integral to this program and integral to education here at Pequannock that do want to say a few words. So, without any further ado, the superintendent of Pequannock Township School District, Mr. Porter.
Well, thank you very much for having me. It's so wonderful to see the 9 scholars who made this night happen. Thank you to the fellow educators who supported them throughout their journey here at Pequannock Township High School. Really thank you to everybody at home who I'm sure has provided an enormous amount of support. I just want to share that for me, growing up, going to school, I didn't associate STEM with being terribly creative. I saw science, I saw math being very formulaic, followed these steps and got this outcome. The work that these scholars have completed for tonight and have been working on over the past 4 years really demonstrates that there's a great deal of creativity to that, that you experiment, you try to figure things out, you find solutions. And to me, they're developing life skills that are going to carry them throughout their lives. And I'm really proud that I can play a very, very small part in it, really by allowing the educators to work with them and allowing them to explore. So I'm very proud to be a part of this, however small, very proud of you for what you've accomplished, and I'm really excited to get a chance to show off your creative work tonight. Thanks for having me, and best of luck, have a great night.
All right, thank you, Mr. Portis. Next, to share a few words, we do have the PTHS principal, Mr. Hazel.
Thank you, everybody. Super excited to be here tonight. I know this is a little different than we had originally planned. What I love about this is that you wanted to be here and present in person. And I think that's a testament to your hard work, your dedication to this program, and your desire to live your excellence. And over the next several weeks, we're going to be talking about that and how you've lived your excellence over the last 4 years with PTHS. And unlike Mr. Portis, I can't speak off the cuff very well, so I like to write down my words. So I apologize for the lead, but before I do begin, I want to thank Mr. Locatel, I want to thank Mr. Murek, Mr. Coe, and Mr. Murphy for being a part of this program with me for the last 4 years. I know you've experienced them in different ways in the classes that you've had, but they each share a certain passion for what they do and connecting, to those real world experiences. And they provided you with opportunities to push boundaries, to challenge your thinking, and most importantly, develop relationships. And hopefully when you look back on your 4 years here, it's those relationships that mean the most, right? You learn the content, but it's really about the relationships that you form with each other and with your teachers. There's no denying the past 15 months have been some of the most difficult times you've experienced in your life. There have been struggle, there's been disappointment, there's been grief, there's been doubt, but there's also been resilience. There's been determination, there's been creativity, there's been wonder, and there's been hope. And over the past several weeks, there's been a palpable feeling of anticipation for the future, one that puts the past behind us and pushes us towards a new day. While we can certainly get caught up in the struggle, we tend to forget that it's the struggle that makes us better. It makes us question, it makes us discover, it makes us open our eyes to opportunities that we didn't know exist. And if you think about what the STEM Academy has done for you here at Pequannock Township High School, it is about embracing the opportunities to follow your passion, to embrace the struggle, to learn, to create, and to succeed. We're going to hear from you tonight and how you've challenged yourself by enrolling in advanced courses that many high school students would not see in high school, or perhaps even their undergraduate degree. Courses such as fundamentals of engineering, robotics, AutoCAD, computer science, 3D prototyping, combined with the math and science courses you took, provided you with a well-rounded education. The opportunity to use simulations, computer programs, laser cutters, multimedia technology, 3D printers, not only enhanced the learning for you, but afforded you the opportunity to design projects in a collaborative way. You're also able to engage in real world experiences through the job shadowing process, where you work with dedicated professionals in a variety of different areas. You were able to witness firsthand the design process, how to work as a team, how to overcome challenges, how to provide support, and most importantly, as I talked about, how to develop relationships with individuals, with businesses, and with each other. As students, and moving on to the next phase of your journey, you're going to be able to take these skills and apply them to your future experiences as you continue to learn, grow, and thrive. Tonight's senior capstone is the culmination of your entire STEM Academy experience. The goal of the capstone was for you to follow the engineering design process and create an invention of your own. With the support of your teachers, your parents, your mentors, your classmates, you've come up with some pretty amazing ideas. Now, I'm talking to Mr. Rockefeller and Ms. Ferentino. I'm really looking forward to seeing this tonight and what's going to happen. While these new inventions are certainly exciting, I want the students to be reminded of the struggle that you took to get here. I want you to be reminded of the failures. As much as you learn through your successes, learn from the struggle. When times get hard, you learn the value of resilience, of perseverance, of dedication, and commitment to finishing what you start. A dream is your creative vision for your life and the future. You must break out of your comfort zone and become comfortable with the unfamiliar and the unknown. This quote by American writer Dennis Waitley describes my dream for each of you. Don't be afraid to step outside your comfort zone and continue to pursue your passion. Broaden your horizon, expand your mind, and there's no telling what you're going to be capable of doing. Thank you for all you've done as part of the STEM Academy program, and I wish you the best of luck. It really has been an honor to watch you grow since I've known all of you since you were in sixth grade, right? And to see you tonight as young men and women is truly just unbelievable. So congratulations, best of luck. And don't forget to breathe when you're up here. Okay? Very, very important. But I know you're gonna do a great job. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Mr. Hazler. Very inspiring words. Finally, before we get to the students, we have the supervisor for STEM and Math, Mrs. Bernardino.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for being here tonight. It really is a special night for our STEM Academy students, and I'm really excited to see their projects. So I'm going to keep it short and sweet. So I'd be remiss if there's a few people that I didn't thank. So I want to start by thanking our administration, the whole administrative team who really worked hard to get these students back into school and who provided all of our STEM Academy students with laptops so that they were able to continue doing the important work that they were doing. So thank you very much for that. I also would like to thank our STEM Academy staff, including Mr. Lafatelle, Mr. Murek, Mr. Murphy, Mr. Coe, Mr. Resigno, and Ms. Sapjeta, for all the work they've done with the students over the past 4 years. Also like to thank our past and present business partners. Unfortunately, some of our business partners could not take our students in this year due to COVID, but we did have Jam Graphics, Dive Design, and HP Motors who did offer internships for our students, so they were able to get out into the business world. And we are hoping to partner again next year and in the future years with our other partners. I'd also like to thank our partners in education at Seton Hall and our new partner in education that'll be joining us for next year, NJIT. And last, I want to thank the STEM Academy class of 2021 for just being like really great kids. I feel like I've spent some time in your classroom. I've gotten to know you a little bit, spent a little time with you, and have heard your presentations and your ideas from the beginning. And you really developed your projects with a lot of passion, and I'm really excited to see them tonight. And I'm wishing you all the best of luck in the future. So congratulations, STEM Academy class of 2021.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Bernardino. So I believe I can speak for all of the STEM teachers that Mrs. Bernardino just listed by just saying how proud we are of our STEM Academy graduates this year. It's truly a fantastic thing to see these young people grow into the almost professionals that they are today. So I really just wanted to make a point before we get to our first presenter on how proud we all are. Two logistical side notes for those of you that are watching at home. Because we are on Zoom and we have multiple cameras showing multiple different angles of these projects and the presentation, at certain points, a presenter might ask you to look at one of the other cameras. While they are all showing, hopefully, depending on your view, you might want to double left click on any view that either you don't see or would like to see more of in order to get a better view of perhaps one of the presenters showing something on the camera up front. Recognize that obviously this isn't the most ideal circumstances, but we are making it work. And thankfully we've done a little bit of practicing and we should have a really nice presentation here. So that being said, Mr. McGorry, if you wouldn't mind taking over.
Well, thank you everyone for coming and thank you everyone who's joining in the Zoom. I really appreciate Mr. Portis, Mr. Hazler, Mr. Locatel, Ms. Brindino, and everyone else who supported us, me and as well everyone in my class along this journey. And to get right into it, for my STEM capstone project this year, I created a snowboard strap, which is designed to eliminate the issue of carrying a snowboard and the dangers that brings along with it. The goal this year was for us to tackle a problem that we saw in the world to whatever scale that we saw fit, and using the engineering and design process that we've been practicing our 4 years in high school to apply that to the problem and in a way to create our solution. We followed a general timeline that was broken up into six major areas. The first area being our problem ideation, where we were brainstorming and selecting these problems. We created a list of questions that we would apply to each of the problems we came up with. And after applying each question to these problems, we were able to identify which problems seemed more viable than others and which ones made the most sense for us to tackle. We narrowed it down to four main issues. I got down to one about snowboarding gear, another one about poorly ventilated rooms, the issue of watering houseplants, and an excessive sweating or hyperhidrosis issue. And once we were at these four ideas, we decided we had to take a little bit more of an extreme approach in figuring out which ones are the best solutions to go with. So we took two forms of data, one being a quantitative form of data collection, which was the creation of Google Forms surveys that we posted all over the internet to try to get as much information from people as we could to get the public's opinion on if this problem was even viable to try to tackle. And our other form was tackling through qualitative data, where we would interview a professional in this specific industry or the specific zone of that scope of issue, and what their opinion on it was, and if they thought it was a viable solution. After going through both of those, it just made the most sense for me to tackle the snowboarding issue, because from the masses, it got the most positive reception. And when I looked at it in terms of what I could accomplish in a year's time with what we had, I figured that was the most logical for me. So after deciding on a problem, we got to an area where we thought about rough sketches, and we kind of started the real finite solution ideation. So I would draw different ideas, basically just brainstorming as much as possible with different variations of sashes, different variations of belts, harnesses, a quick release mechanism. I basically threw as much as I could at this problem, just dumping my brain into it to see what I could create personally. It went through a bunch of different variations from a strap to backpacks and many different things. But then we got to a point where we transferred those sketches into 3D models, basically using a software either called Inventor, Fusion 360, or many other 3D modeling softwares that we familiarized ourselves with through the course of high school. These are 3D renders of the physical or of the 3D models that I created. So these were different ideas for a quick release mechanism that I designed, basically designed to make it so you can carry your gear quickly on and off, take it off, and not have to worry about carrying it all in your hands, dropping it, that kind of thing. It was designed as a secure method for holding it in place, but also where you could quickly have access to it. So these are 3D renders I created. A few different variations. I went through many different ideas. This is the idea I ended up going with, and this was the final solution of it, where I just dirtied up the hook and a few other ways. But overall, it was just a lot of 3D renders went into this ideation phase of bringing those sketches into a 3D model we could visualize into what we would eventually create. So this was another 3D render of the backpack design I created. And then we got into the physical prototyping phase. This was probably the bulk of the project for me. And this is where the problems really arise, where I saw some issues, some failures that kind of boosted me into a different direction. So first I modeled I started 3D printing the quick release. So we used a resin-based 3D printer that would cure layers of resin. I used this to create different quick release designs. I went through many iterations, testing tolerances and what would fit and what wouldn't to make sure I could get the most ideal solution. It took about 3 or 4 different iterations, but I finally got to one that fit perfectly. I was able to get magnets in snug, and it was just the ideal solution for the problem I wanted to tackle. Then I was also onto the backpack phase. This backpack phase of my project took weeks probably of my time and led me to a dead end, but it also led me into a realization of what I could have made. So this was, I borrowed a sewing machine from middle school, and I used that to sew an Arctic nylon designed to withstand temperatures up to negative 30 degrees Fahrenheit. And so I used that. It was my first time sewing, so it was a learning experience for me for sure. The problem arose with the backpack was just in idea and in 3D models, it made sense practically, but I didn't have it in a physical aspect to where I didn't realize what I was capable of. And I didn't realize the scope of what I was trying to create wasn't something that I was able to achieve. So I realized this backpack design wasn't exactly what I wanted to go for. And that brought me to my actual final result, which was a strap design. So these are more 3D renders of the strap. I created this in more of an idea of something that was lightweight, a little more versatile for what I wanted to achieve. And it just encompassed more of what I originally wanted to set out to do instead of the backpack, which derailed me a bit from my original idea. So these are some 3D renders of my idea. It straps along the outside of the bindings, and it'll hold the backpack over your shoulder, or it'll hold the snowboard over your shoulder, like a sash basically. And when I physically created it, it worked pretty well. I had a few issues with it, but overall it did what I set out to achieve. It fit on the board perfectly. And overall, it ended up being that idea of it got what I wanted to achieve, but it also was the versatile portable option, which wasn't what I originally set out to do, but it ended up being a good solution and a good little side part of the project. And in the future, if I was to tackle this again, what would I change? I have a few things and more of, part of this learning experience for me was that planning is a major issue. And if you don't, if I didn't plan out every single little aspect, I was bound to run into issues, and I did. So when I was in my initial planning phase, I should have thought about all those initial issues that could have arisen and think about every detailed part of this process. Because I didn't think about all that. I kind of just said, I'll tackle it when I get to it. And that put me down a bad path. I also should have thought about more material testing, because I kind of went with the material and ran with it, which I didn't hate, but I didn't get to test it practically. So that might have arose some issues. I also just wish I made a more versatile product. Mine works for me and it works for my specific situation. But say I was to mass produce this, it would be an issue for working for many people. And thank you guys for your time. I appreciate everyone coming out today and taking a look at my project. That's all. Next up is my classmate, Brendan Arnold.
Hi, everyone. Before I begin, I'd just like to thank everyone who joined the Zoom. I, as well as my fellow classmates, really appreciate you all tuning into the Zoom and listening to our Capstone projects. So my presentation is split up into 3 portions: the origin of the project, the designing a solution portion, and then the final results. So the origin of the project began in September 2020. We as a class identified 10 possible problems per person that we could solve. It could be related to COVID or just any other general endangerment to people. Then in October, we underwent class and self-evaluations of the problem of our 10 problems. And from those evaluations, we chose 4 to make a presentation on. These were a couple of my problems with speeding, a lack of clean water in certain areas, and something more simple like fire pit smoke getting people's faces. And in the bottom right is how the class thought each of my problems were like effective wise. And then from there, I chose 4 of the highest rated problems to present. And in November 2020, we showed these presentations to some administrators and fellow teachers. And these are my first two problems. My first one was ladder stability. And my second problem was chlorine and how it affects your skin under a mask. And basically the gist of our presentations was an intro to each problem, then surveys where we converted them into charts from like the internet. And then we interviewed real life people on how they thought our problem was. And these are my other two problems, produce rot and hand sanitizer bottles not being an effective way of storing hand sanitizer. And then from December to May 2020, we drew design concepts for a chosen problem and made our physical prototypes. Okay, so my chosen project was the ladder stability. And basically the goal of it was to reduce ladder fall related accidents. And some possible solutions I came up were a mat under the ladder, a sort of cleat to cling it to the ground, and a step cover. I chose this problem because my father has almost fallen off a ladder multiple times. And basically what he does is he leans it against our back door to clean our gutters. So if someone opens the door, the entire ladder falls over. And also my interviewed expert, Mr. Barbosa's neighbor fell off a ladder and actually broke her neck. My first part of the journey on this issue was creating ladder sketches, and it includes all the possible design concepts for my problem. These include bigger bases for each ladder, leg, cleats that go into the ground, a mat that just keeps it from slipping in general. And then towards the end, I focused more on like step covers, like something with like a crampon, like texture on top, just to prevent water slippage and to prevent just in general slippage. Then after our sketches, we created 3D models in Inventor. My first model is of my real life ladder at home. I created a scale model in Inventor to base my prototypes off of. And then from there, my first prototype was the cleat. And I made this cleat based off of the ladder you just saw. And this is like this is the original solution to my problem. But after I decided to go with the ladder cover, because I figured it was a more effective way of preventing ladder slippage on the ladder rather than the ladder falling in general. So this is my first version of the cover. It has a couple indented lines and like extruded lines at the very top to prevent like your shoes from slipping, like if it's wet or if it's raining. This is my second version of the ladder step cover. Instead of lines, it has little circles as a texture, sort of like what's on the bottom of a shoe when you go to like Sky Zone or any other place where there could be slippery accidents. And this is my third and final version of the step cover, where I based it off of a non-slip shoe that I had, and I changed the circles to rectangles. And then from there, I decided the way I would make my ladder cover is I would mold it using a silicone and latex mold. And this portion of the presentation includes my mold failures, mold successes, and the materials I used. So my materials were the yellow and blue tubes are a part A and part B solution for silicone rubber. And basically what you do is you mix them together and it creates the outline where from there I dumped the rubber latex and the silicone latex into it to make a stretchier version of what I 3D printed. So my first attempt was a test attempt with a little medallion that I had. And basically what I did is I used the little white box to pour the A and B material in, and it came out like this. So the coin is in there, and while it's curing, it's molding each and every feature of the coin. This is how the negative mold came out. It came out pretty well. You can see all the details from the medallion. And then from there, I used the rubber latex to reproduce it in a more stretchier form. My second test was with my one of the renders of the ladder cover I had. I made the negative mold out of a 3D prototype and the A and B silicone material. And this is how it came out. And then from there, I used the rubber latex, but what happened was only the top portion would cure, since that was the only part exposed to oxygen. If you notice on the very bottom of it, all the whiter material, it's still liquid and still sticky. And from here, this caused a lot of failures. I've used almost $60 extra of material just trying to get the rubber latex to work. Here's some more failures. And This is why, this is like a closer in-depth look at the rubber latex after it cures. So if you notice, as I'm peeling away the little container I poured it in, you can see the top layer, like a really thin top layer, is cured. Meanwhile, the bottom is all sticky and gooey, and it was just a big mess. I even tried using the AMB solution on the AMB solution, but that created a giant blue square that was no use to me. Here are some more failures as a result of the rubber latex. And then from there, I decided to switch up what materials I was using. I used the very last of the AMB material to create a final, more accurate ladder step cover. This is from my final render. These came out well, and I actually based my final product off of the little black design in the left of the screen. So after I used all of my AMB solution, I ordered some extra off of Amazon, and I decided to replace the rubber latex with like a foamy material as well as flex seal to add a hydrophobic property to my ladder cover. And this is how it came out. It's basically, I use the foam to make a negative mold, and I use the AMB solution as a substitute to the latex since that was able to cure even without oxygen. And it fits on the ladder perfectly. It extends the width a significant amount, and it's also hydrophobic. That's me stepping on it. It's securely fastened onto the ladder. It won't slip off. And here's a video of the hydrophobic properties. As you can see, even though water's running on it, in a few seconds you'll see the water clumps up and even just slips off. If you notice, I put my sock onto the water and it still comes out relatively dry. So that was a big advantage with the slippage issue. Here's a closer up picture of the hydrophobic properties. You can see the water's all clumped, and it just relatively looks a little safer than a normal ladder step. I did have to replace the texture with this property, but I still think it was an even trade-off. Thank you. And my next presenter is Jordan Latour.
Hi everyone, thank you all for coming today. What I'll be presenting to you is the tertia oculis. This is Latin for third eye. And how I went through the problem solving process, I started off with brainstorming, and then I went to designing. So I was sketching and ideating what my possible solutions could be. And finally, I started on the construction where I actually built my physical prototype. So first off with the brainstorming, when I was trying to come up with a solution that I thought everybody encountered throughout their everyday life, I stepped through what I went through that day, and I realized when I was driving, there had been multiple cases of people crashing into me or me crashing into other people because I just couldn't see them in my blind spot and they couldn't see me. So I figured this could be a big problem because I reviewed multiple traffic cameras to see what the most common cause of accidents were. And I found that a large portion of them were from people not being able to see into their blind spots. So once I found that problem, I started moving on to how I could solve this. So I figured that if drivers had some way to know if there was another car in their blind spot, then this would be less likely to happen. So the best way to notify them could be with a light indicator, which sticks out very obviously. It would be placed on the side mirror or around it so that whenever they're checking their lanes, they would see it. These are my first sketches. So I toyed with the idea of putting it on the A pillar so that whenever they were checking their side mirrors, it would be in the corner of their eye. And I knew that the way that these indicators could get a signal to whether there was a car in the blind spot or not would be with the sonar sensor, which detects distance and would be able to tell how close another car is from your car. And then when I was sketching how the sonar sensor would see the other cars, I thought that would be a good idea to put it on the back of the car where they would be jetting out to the side and could see other cars right next to the car in the blind spot. And then when I was finally coming upon my final sketch, I moved on to putting the indication light on the actual side mirror, because the problem with the A pillar is that if you were checking your right lane, you would have to check the left side of your car to be able to see if there was something in your right lane, which could become hazardous eventually. And I also moved the sonar sensor to the fender of the car, because this would be more aerodynamic. And I gave it a ramp shape so that air could just glide over it. And it would be held onto the car with some kind of adhesive so that it wouldn't leave any permanent marks on your car. And once I had all my sketches done, I finally moved on to constructing it. The first step of my construction was actually sketching them up in CAD. This is a very powerful tool which you can use to then translate something into the real world using 3D printing or in any other type of milling. And the two programs I used for this were Fusion 360 and Inventor. Once I finally got my CAD models sketched up, this is what they look like. They were just basically copies of my sketches. And these are all different views of them. As you can see, there is an LED inside of the indicator itself, which would light up whenever the sonar sensor detected something in the blind spot. And here's an example of where it would sit on the car. So the sonar sensor would be located right above the tire on the fender, and the indicator would be located in the top left corner or the top right corner of the side mirror. So these are what I would figure. This is what I figured I would use to actually bring them into the real world. The Arduino would be used as basically the brains for everything. It's a very powerful microprocessor that can be used to take in and then give out an output based on what it receives. The Creatality resin printer uses resin. It cures each layer at a time to create very fine models, which can have very great tolerances. And the FDM printer, I used that basically for just my prototypes. I didn't use that for my final models because I liked the precision that I got with the resin printer. Once I got all my wiring set up, this is what it looked like. I had two sonar sensors and two LEDs, one for each side of the car. And then once I was done with the wiring, I actually started printing all of my designs. And this is what it looks like assembled. And then I moved on to the indicator. And once I got that assembled, I figured it was time to start actually putting everything together. So here, I will show you my final result.
This is just an apparatus that I looked up to demonstrate how this works. So this sonar sensor actually has a beeping rate dependent on how far the object is from it. And there is even a tolerance point where once it gets to this point, it's no longer possibly a threat, so it just turns off. And then as it moves farther away, it turns back on. And then once it gets to a certain point, it just turns off completely.
Thank you all for watching my presentation. And up next, I'd like to introduce to you, Evan Flame.
Hello, I'm Evan Flame. I'd like to start out by saying a quick thank you to everybody that's come here in person as well as in Zoom. I can say for myself as well as all of my fellow STEM Academy students that we are very grateful to all of our administrators that have been helping us this entire time. So let's jump into it. So my project, my STEM Capstone project, is the Nasus Vectus, which is Latin for a nose bar. So the timeline of our project is I have mine split up into four stages. The first one is defining our problems, the second being choosing a project, the third, we created solution ideations, and then finally we had our final project created. So first up, we have defining our problems. Me as well as my classmates came up with 10 different problems. This was the most creative part of our process. We just picked like pretty much anything that we could think of that could possibly be a problem that we could fix ourselves, and we would narrow it down to four different problems of the 10 by using various methods such as interviews, interviews, Google Forms, my bad, interviews, Google Forms, and just like answering questions like, would these problems actually be worth solving? So my four that I narrowed it down to were, sometimes ceiling fan lights are too bright, your glasses tend to fog up when you're wearing a mask, which is a very prominent problem in today's world. Sometimes your beach balls or pool floaties, you need to deflate them fast and to put them away for storage. And also wires for computers just tend to get unorganized very quickly. And the only way to solve that is with manual labor. So from those four problems, again, we narrowed it down from the four to one by doing the same thing. We asked around, we had Google Forms created, we interviewed people, and I decided that the best one would probably be blocking your breath from fogging up your glasses with something. Not sure what yet at this point, but something. The other ones weren't really practical. Not many people actually faced with problems. So I went with the nose block. So my problem was the fact that when you wear glasses, your breath will sometimes go from your nose down, hit the mask. It'll travel in all different directions, sometimes out the sides, sometimes on the bottom, but most importantly, up, out, and through the top and into your glasses, fogging up your vision, which is not exactly the best. So this is where I went through creating different solution ideations of how we could stop the breath from hitting your glasses and fogging it up. So first I just created rough sketches, very rough, I'm not the best artist. So here we have, I had an idea of a vent that would be put onto a mask that would allow air to travel out, but not back in through hinges, or maybe some sort of a thing that connected to your glasses into the mask that would prevent the air from coming up. On here, I thought of maybe putting more things in the inside of the mask, like maybe a foam blocker, a rubber blocker, or just another shield that would block your air from hitting your glasses, or something that went over your nose. So these are some of my 3D models that I created. This one was the vent idea. I kind of scrapped this one. It wasn't really the best. It was going to be too clunky. And, I'd have to just create, you wouldn't be able to like remove it from the mask. It would be stuck in the mask if you want to wear a different one. You really wouldn't be able to. So I decided to go for a more circular, so it was less clunky. But this one, again, it just was going to make the mask really heavy and then it would, weigh down the mask. Again, not the best. So then I started to come up with something for that would go over your nose to prevent the air from hitting your glasses. So this is the first nose bar I created. It's a bit large. This bottom part would go on your nose and the top part would block the air. But again, too large would make your mask almost fall off all the time. This one was the first almost comfortable, almost, because it's got very sharp edges, which not very great for sitting on your face, probably poke your eye out. So I decided to go with a more sleeker design, but again, these rounded edges on the bottom kind of cut into your face and just very annoying. So then I came up with this final, almost St. Louis arc version where they would rest on your nose and then your mask would keep it on. However, through testing with this one, the air would still get through the sides and it wouldn't really work that well. So these are the failed prints of those models that I showed. So this is the sharp one on the left, as well as the first curvy one on the right. This were some more failed prints. This is the St. Louis arc, the first one on the right. And again, another version of the curved one on the left. And then, spoiler for my final project on the left, it was broken. The bars on the side were a bit too thin, so it snapped off within like the first 10 minutes of testing. And another version of the St. Louis arc on the right. So finalizing the solution, this is where I took the culmination of everything that I learned from testing and modeling and decided to put it into one big project, which is the NASA Spectus, which I'm actually wearing right now. Hold on. The NASA Spectus, which you can also see on screen. I just realized you can't see it. So the final prototype has the St. Louis arc build, which is very comfortable for your nose, as well as these two wings on the side, which block any extra air that decides to hit the top of the blocker and decide to go sideways. It'll hit those and then hopefully travel down. So these are some of the models that I have currently in my hands. There's a clear one as well as a white one. I kind of like the white one better just because it's more solid looking and cleaner. And this is a flatter view of it so you can see the curved edges. So that way there's nothing sharp hitting your face. And overall, it's just more comfortable for your face.
So how you use it is you place the bridge. Can I take my mask off real quick? So as one of the my models, so you take it, you put it over your nose as so, then you take your mask, put it on, and the pressure from your mask on your ears keeps it from falling down off of your mask, and it, you know, stays on. Here's what it should look like in the mask. And then we have another one of my models showing how it really works. So the air from your nose blows out, it'll hit the mask, go in all different directions, but if it goes up towards your glasses, it'll instead hit the blocker and go straight down and out of your mask. Thank you. I would next like to introduce Gianna Lorenzo.
Hello, everyone. My name is Gianna Lorenzo, and this is my STEM capstone presentation. First, I'd like to thank everyone once again, like all my classmates said, for being here. So I've decided to create an ectogestation chamber, and I'll go into a little bit of depth about what that is later. So everyone has touched on it briefly before, but I just wanted to go through the process once again. So first, our task was to define problems that we face or someone we knew faced or any problem that we wanted to tackle. And after coming up with 10 problems, we narrowed it down to 4. We got numerous surveys and interviews about each, and we came to the conclusion of one final idea, and we started to sketch and design for that. And after many rounds of sketching, we began 3D and physical prototyping. And finally, after a total of around 29 weeks, a final solution was designed and created, which is going to be presented to you today. So the problem that I'd like to tackle is the fact that every year, 15 million babies are born premature, in which 25% of them do not survive. And I do understand that this is a very broad topic and something that most likely will never be able to be fully fixed, but it is something that I'd like to somewhat change. And I'll go into depth about the precursors later of this problem already. So because it's such a in-depth idea and problem, I needed to complete a lot of research. So I added a little fact about how there's something called the gray Z area at 23 weeks of gestation, in which only about a third of premature babies survive. And at 24 weeks, the odds of survival double. So this just shows you that just a little bit more time of development will increase the chances of survival. So an ectogestation chamber or artificial womb is pretty much a scientific idea that was created to help a baby live longer instead of being born premature. So the idea fascinated me because it's interesting how science and engineering can help save someone's life, not just in something like a prosthetic or a medical device, but something for babies that haven't even been born yet. And even though it's something that already has been made and tested, and it's currently being solved, I think that tackling this problem or trying to mock what has already been created will help bring some bring recognition to the change that's happening. So first is the precursors, which I kind of go into detail about here, in which in 2017, researchers at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia were able to successfully keep a lamb fetus alive for 4 weeks in a chamber like the one that I've created that was designed to imitate a mother's womb. So then I go into depth about the different components that are needed, including a chamber, a fluid-filled bag, IV nutrients, an oxygen pump, and an amniotic fluid pump that goes in and out. First is the oxygen pump, in which it is needed to circulate the blood that's taken through the umbilical cord, which filters out carbon dioxide and replenishes the blood with proper nutrients. And this is the one aspect of the whole artificial womb that I wasn't able to create due to the fact that I don't have the funding or the credentials for it. Secondly is the amniotic fluid pump, which is the main thing that I focused on in this project. And that is made to circulate the amniotic fluid in the bio bag, which ensures that the fetus is housed in a proper temperature and nourishing environment, and the IV nutrients, which is an IV bag that supplies nutrients to the fetus, which includes lipids, antibiotics, amino acids, proteins, and glucose. Then you have the chamber, which is needed to make sure that there aren't any leaks, and if so, they can be contained. And it's also a very important transportation method for the actual bio bag. And then the most important thing, the fluid-filled bag or bio bag, which houses the fetus and will contain amniotic fluid to mimic a mother's womb. So how it works is that approximately 23 weeks or later, a fetus will be placed in a bio bag for growth. It will still have its umbilical cord attached and it will be housed in the fluid-filled bag within the chamber. Multiple pumps will circulate the amniotic fluid in and out of the bag, and an oxygen pump will circulate the blood and oxygen through the umbilical cord. The IV bag will then provide nutrients through multiple locations, including the amniotic pumps and the oxygen pumps. After I did my research, I needed to start designing. So I came up with some different sketches for different subjects for it, whether it was the actual womb itself, which here you can see that there were some more simple designs and then futuristic, and some that were kind of just interesting, like the one on the bottom, which uses a bag as almost a carrying tool. But I went into the components that are needed, and this is where I was able to narrow out what was not necessarily needed, like an artificial kidney or many different air sources or CO2 analyzers. Then I went into the different materials that I was going to use, whether it was different heat enhanced materials or warm quarter or different pumps. Then after that, we went into 3D prototyping, whereas mine, I didn't really need to do as much of this because most of it was a physical prototype, but I created a simple design of what I wanted the box to look like, as well as a way to, the little thing on the bottom is a way to house the different cords and the different tubing for the actual box. And then these are the final 3D models for the actual bio bag itself. These are different valves that I used, and I'll show later in the actual model. Then I went into testing, which was one of the most difficult portions because I needed to figure out how the different pumps worked in coordination with one another. So here's some pictures of the valves itself. I had some trouble at first with the bag, trying to get the pumps, the valves in, due to the fact that it was a vacuum sealed bag, which I will also show later. Then these were the different pumps that I've used. One is actually a fish pump for a fish tank, which actually was the most useful pump that I have in the actual project. And then finally is the final design. These are some photos of the actual box with laser cut holes allowing access for the different tubing. Then the actual bag itself, which was made out of kitchen vacuum sealed food sealer bags with the pumps, with the valves, with silicone to keep them watertight. Then the tubing, you can see here, I used different size tubings to allow for detachable tubes. So there's one physically connected to the actual valve, which will permanently stay there, whereas the thicker tubes will be able to detach in case of emergency or in case of them needed to be swapped out. Then on the left is a photo of the IV bag and how that enters the actual pump itself. And on the right picture is a photo of the hand pump vacuum that I have. Now I'm going to be showing a demonstration.
Okay, so there is a pump in here which circulates blood, which circulates amniotic fluid from a chamber through this tube, which then connects to an IV bag, which then would be released and then flows through the tubes as well into the bag. Then there's an output chamber which runs out of the bag, and this is where that there would be a filter which would then circulate back through and run as a continuous cycle.
And lastly, I just want to talk about the different changes that I would make. So obviously, if I did have the credentials and I did have the money, I'd want to create a inner layer that would allow you to demonstrate the actual blood and oxygen pump itself. And that's pretty much it. So thank you again for listening, and thank you. And next is Thomas Troutwine.
Hello, welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Thomas Troutwine, and this is my STEM capstone project. So first, what is our STEM capstone? It all revolves around our ideas of how we want to solve a problem. We need to find a problem that we want to solve. So how I interpreted this is seeing problems in my personal everyday life. And so what I had to think to myself is, what do I want to fix? What is there a problem that I experience every day that I want to eliminate, that I want to fix? And the first thing that came to my mind was my family's chicken coop, its security. Because a lot of times whenever we let them out, walk around the yard, you have to be personally with them, protecting them from any predators that might be around, such as like a hawk or a fox in our bushes. So now I'm thinking to myself, how can I eliminate the threat of predators? So to do this, my first train of thought was how to stop them from getting into the coop. How can I make it more difficult for a fox to burrow under, or make it more difficult for a hawk to dive down at them? So first I began thinking of ways to make it harder to enter the coop, but that one issue that I began realizing with that was each chicken coop is very unique and different because it's usually personally built. So if I was to make something physical, it would be difficult to apply it to all different coops. So I began to think in a more way of, how can I stop predators from coming to the coop at all in the first place? How do I stop them from just not even getting there? So I came up with the idea of using frequencies. And I began researching different animals' tolerance to different frequencies. And I discovered chickens have a very low frequency tolerance, which means after a certain high-pitched sound threshold, they can no longer hear the sound. Humans are, like an average adult male, is usually between 15 and 20 hertz of sound. And once sound passes that threshold, a little bit past it will cause your ears to hurt or approaching the threshold. And once you pass it, you can no longer hear the sound. However, things that are harmful to chickens, such as a fox trying to bury in to eat them, or a rat trying to steal their food, or a dog scaring them, all are very sensitive to high frequency sounds. So I began to think of something like a white noise machine, something that can emit a sound at night when no one's around that can stop predators from coming near the coop. So I began making some sketches, and I resulted in this. This is basically the bare bones of my product, where it's an Arduino board that's using a light sensor to register what time of day it is. And it's registering if it's light out or if it's dark out. And once the light sensor reads, oh, it's dark out, it will tell the speaker to play a high-pitched noise. And that speaker will be constantly emitting this noise, and the chickens will not feel anything from it. They won't even know what's happening. So now to make something that can house this equipment, I started making different types of 3D models. First, I wanted to have something that could mount to the wall and that I could have some sort of control panel on it to set the speaker. Then I started making this sort of octagonal type shape. Then I moved into this one, which I thought would give the best amount of echo function by bouncing the sound around on different walls. However, it wasn't very efficient in its space use. So I went down a more simple path of just a basic box with a few holes in the side. Now I will show you over here.
This is my STEM capstone project. It is a predator deterrent system for a chicken coop. The idea behind it is that when night falls, when predators are most active. It will emit a high frequency sound that will harm predators that try and get near it. It'll hurt their ears, make them want to run away from it. While on the other side, it won't affect the chickens because chickens have a low frequency hearing. So they won't be able to pick up or detect sounds that are too high. So it'll leave the chickens unharmed and scare away any predators. For a demonstration, I've turned the frequency down, but what I'm going to do right now is just take this cloth and cover the daylight sensor inside to make it think that it's currently nighttime. And as I'm covering that, you hear that loud beep. That loud beep is saying it's nighttime, and that is the sound that would scare away predators.
And thank you all for watching my Capstone project. And I'd like to now introduce Matthew Mostek to take a photo.
Hello, my name is Matthew Mostek. Like everyone said, I kind of said it better myself. Thank you all for joining the Zoom, and I will begin talking about my project, Ignis. So as everyone went through our timeline of the project, we started 10 problems, ideas, drew sketches, prototype modeled, tested the physical models, and now we are in phase 5, where we are finalizing and now presenting our project. So the problem I ran into while choosing what I wanted to talk about was, while I was talking to my mom, she mentioned how when she lived in Poland, everybody there owned a fire extinguisher in their car. And I realized that here in the States, not many people do that. So as I did more research, I found that between the years 2014 and 2016, 171,500 car fires occurred on the highway. And out of every 1,000 of them, two of them had fatalities. So I realized that this was a solution that I could possibly fix. And I thought I could bring something forward to the table. So the scope of my solution would not be to completely put out the fire, because I know that would be virtually impossible. But instead, it would be to give them enough time to escape and get to a more survivable area and kind of just leave the car, because you can always get a new one. You can never, you know, get a new life. So with my first round of ideation sketches, I thought of handheld devices. And while going through them, they seemed like a good idea, but then I realized that I shouldn't be dependent on the person that is trying to get out of the car and leave. They should be focused on just leaving the car and not really trying to put out the fire themselves. So with that, I decided to try something else. Here, the flaps would open at the top and the chemical or flame retardant would fly out of the device. And here I have something similar, except now it would be a little bit more explosive and the top would fly off, and so would the flame retardant, which means I would have a larger area of coverage. And so with my second round of sketches, I decided to really focus on that with the side cycle here on the left side, where this would preferably spin, and on the sides, it would throw out the chemicals, so I have a really large area of coverage. However, the problem I ran into was I had no coverage underneath it. And so with that, I decided to create the shower, as I called it. However, with this, while it has a great area of coverage, I had no idea on how I would be able to kind of throw out the chemicals. It was a little bit too difficult, and I thought that this wasn't really worth it. I could create something better. So then I created what I called the camera opening and the spinning shower. However, similar to the spin cycle like I had previously, I did not have enough coverage on the side. This had great coverage underneath it and would be able to pour out a lot of the chemicals. However, no coverage on the side, I did not find it to be worth it. So I decided to branch out and try other topics, such as this airbag, where it would be pressurized, and at a specific point, instead of just melting the bag would burst because it had enough pressure, and the chemicals inside the bag would burst out and have a lot of area covered. However, similar to before, I did not know and was not confident on how to do this. And so I decided to take another approach. So instead of a large scale project, I decided to see if I could do a lot of mini scale projects to be really specific in the areas that I would try to cover. So I had this array set up on the right side, and what it would be, it was underneath the car hood, it would be lines of wire connecting each one. And when the fire or it would be detected, it would all send out at the same time. However, I did not think that having a bunch of wires underneath the car hood would be good. It's basically very ironic to what I'm trying to solve. And trying to get these all to activate at once and on such a minuscule level would be very difficult for me. And I did not find that it would be worth it. So with my final design, I thought of this idea. I labeled it the UFO. because it sort of looks like one. And here you have the top and bottom, both having great coverage above it and on the sides of it. And in practicality, my idea was that the top and bottom would be spinning in opposite directions. So whatever the bottom missed, the top would miss, and vice versa. So with the 3D models, I began with the spin cycle. Very quickly realized that I was not a fan of this, mostly because the lack of space it provided, the lack of storage it had, and the lack of coverage that it would have on the final project. So here I have another model where in theory it would be with the motor. And you can already see that it takes up a lot of space and it's not very compact. It goes everywhere and it probably would not be the best. And the reason why half of it is covered is because I want to display that how much the storage would be inside. So with that, I decided to go with the UFO. And here we have the top and bottom separated just a little bit. And in theory, the idea was to try and get them to spin opposite directions, as I mentioned before. However, I had no idea how to do that. I had thought of using some gears, using two motors, quickly became out of my reach and out of my scope. So I decided, why should I do that? I could just focus on one half. So originally, this was the idea that I had for this one half design, where the motor would be inside the base of the project. However, I quickly realized that the way this would be set up would be where this flat top would be aiming down at the car engine. Obviously, just to preface, this would be mirrored on both sides, so it's not just half of it. And the motor, which you see in the middle, the bottom of that would be on top of the car hood. So if you can imagine that, then you could basically see how this has no coverage underneath it. And that was a big problem that I had with every other problem. So very simply, I decided to flip it over. And so with that, I printed it. And with that, I came with this. So on the left side, you see me attaching the axle to the DC motor. And in the middle picture is what the original design would be before I flipped it. And on the right side is what came out. In reality, what I would have liked to do in the future was shorten the axle just a little bit, make it a little bit more compact, have the same functionality, but it would just be a little bit more compact that I could fit in tighter spaces. So now with this, I have a physical model in my hand. I need to get a flame retardant. I need to find a chemical that would be working with this. And obviously water is not viable. It wouldn't work too well. And not all fires work with water. So I got some sodium bicarbonate. And you can see in this video, as I decide to pour it on, it smothers the fire completely. However, if you do notice, like I mentioned, the scope of my solution, there's still embers there, which means that there's a possibility it could still reignite. However, without the flames, it has a much smaller chance of reigniting, a much smaller chance of putting the person in danger. So now that we have a lot of the groundwork set up, we need to figure out how to activate this. So here on the left side, you see all the circuitry. On the right side is basically where the heart of this whole project is. So instead of having it set off at a peak temperature, I decided to look at changes in temperature. This is mostly due to the fact that if your car is running on a hot summer day, it can get really hot, but it won't catch on fire, and that might set off an accidental activation of the device. So if you look at the differences in them, that would eliminate that problem and be able to make it be a lot more specific for what you have. So that's what's shown here on the right side. Excuse me. So obviously this needs to get powered as well. So I talked to a lot of teachers, a lot of my peers. At first I thought of running a battery. However, I realized very quickly that that probably would not be the best idea. So instead I decided to use a transformer as shown here. And it would most likely be connected to the car battery so that it would have basically the same lifespan as the car battery until it had to get changed. And it would just be a lot easier than having to replace the battery every year or so. So with this, as I mentioned before, the chemical has to be kept inside the device, and that would be used with the use of doors. And so these hinges and doors took a long time to create, mostly because it's a small piece of the project, and it's a very specific for what it has to do. So here we have multiple sizes and multiple gaps of the project. Here's the first iteration of it. And here's the second and the final iteration that I decided to go with. You can see I added the back plate, which is mostly for the ease of gluing. It makes it so it has a solid surface to adhere to. However, this did prove to not be the best idea, because you can see clearly at the bottom of the product there's a larger gap, and that would make it so that the chemical falls through. Here are more pictures of it. The top is fine, however, still at the bottom we have large gaps. So with this, I mentioned that the doors need to open. They can't just be floppy. They need to stay closed, but once it's activated, it needs to open up. So with the use of magnets and a lot of glue, I decided to use my first test, and that is with this. You can see the object is spinning at a fast rate, but in slow motion, you can see at a certain speed, it will open. So now with the fact that I have one done, we have to do this 5 more times. So I'll cut this video a little bit short because it is quite long. You can see as it's spinning, all the doors are opening, and it might not seem that they're going at the same time, but in reality, if it's not slowed down, it is a matter of maybe half a second. So they are all virtually going at the same time. And eventually that door, by the way, will open. Just that I don't want to take too much time. So now with that, we have to do a test, see if it actually works. So at first I'll show the idea we have. So here it is, lots of coverage. You can see all the doors are opening at once. It's even getting underneath it a little bit, which is what I was really aiming for. And obviously in the final project, the top would be covered, but for this sake, it is not. And so for now, I would like to do a physical demonstration.
This is a demonstration of my project. Here you see we've loaded it with the sodium bicarbonate on the inside. This is the circuitry, and right here about is where the thermistor is sensing the temperature. So as I explained before, it is taking the difference instead of the actual temperature that is in the room. It's taking difference between different intervals of the temperature. So if I hold down on it right now, it should calculate the difference between the temperature of before and after, and with that it will turn on. And once it activates and spins fast enough, the doors will open and the sodium bicarbonate will be launched out of the device.
So some future improvements, because there's a lot I feel like I could change and improve with this. One of them simply being changing the doors from magnets to springs. I understand that in a car, there's a lot of metal and magnets tend to stick to metal. So with that, if I could change it from magnets to springs, I feel like it would remove a lot of the outside effects that the metal would have on it, and in turn, make it a lot of a better design. And also, I'd like to limit the gap. I'm not sure if you can see, but there's a lot of dead space that could be used for sodium bicarbonate, which is the flame retardant that I was using. So with that, I feel like that could increase the productivity of my project and make it so that it works a lot better and give it a wider area of coverage. And with that, I'd like to thank you all for listening in on my project. And I'd like to hand it off to Derek here.
Hi, my name is Derek Seary, and I would like to thank you all for joining us on the Zoom tonight. We really appreciate it. I would also like to extend a thank you to those that were listed on the first few slides. They've helped us get as far as we are, and we couldn't be here without them. So that being said, my STEM capstone project is called the Acrylic Assistant. What it is it is to help people who wear longer acrylic nails do things that would inhibit them to do. As they say, beauty is pain, and I want to limit that pain. So we all had to start by choosing a problem. I started by just like throwing stuff at a wall to see what sticks. And as I came up with ideas, nothing really spoke to me. And then one day I went home and my sister, who wears acrylic nails, complained that when she reached to open her car door, she jammed basically all of her fingers into the side of her car because she forgot she had them on. She had gotten them the previous day. So after that, I had to decide what I wanted to do with this acrylic nail tool. So I decided that the things that I wanted to have on it were some sort of hook to handle car doors, moving things across the table because it's hard to pick things up off of a flat surface, and to open just anything that you could think of that a hook could handle. I also thought that possibly a stylus would be good because people who wear acrylic nails have to type with the sides of their thumbs, if you didn't know, because they can't go head on because acrylic doesn't work on phones. I also wanted a comfortable handle because why would you use something that's uncomfortable? There are better options. And I wanted something that could grip things off the table. Then I realized that that is too much to put on one thing. So I decided to get rid of the gripping tool because that already has things that could accomplish it. Like if you carry around just anything in your pocket, you could somehow find a way to pick something up. And the other things were more pressing to me. So using those things, I came up with my first model. As you can see, it has a hook. The divot that you see towards the top by the hook is slightly larger than the average finger size of a fully grown human. So it's comfortably fit. Then I decided to do a stress analysis on it because if it's going to be moving doors and car doors, then it has to be strong enough. And as you could see, it would break pretty easily. If you could see, it bends upwards quite a bit. And that's not what we're looking for because the material that I was using would break if it bent that far. And it did. So then I changed what I was doing. I added supports to the top. As you could see, there's kind of a square shape that leads up into the hook portion. And that is kind of acting as a bracer to stop the hook from bending that much. You might think that it's still bending a lot, but it's a major improvement to what it was doing before. And that led me to my first stable print. So this was one of my first prints. I needed to sand it down to remove support material because printers can't just have things float. But this started to work. It didn't have anything to connect the two pieces yet, but I had a basis. I was using sorts of glue to have them bind together. And so this is the two pieces separated. And then I realized something. The people who primarily have acrylic nails are women. And a big thing that women have to deal with is, say, when they go to the store at night and they're walking to their car alone, they're kind of in fear that something happened to them. So I decided to change the stylus, which was going to be at the bottom, and replace it with something that could help them more in the moment. If they're going to use it to open their car, then why not make it also a self-defense tool so they're already holding it? I also decided that along with the adhesion, like with the glue and stuff, I would also add snap so the two pieces could fit together and be glued. So it would be very easy to combine. So here are the conjunctive snaps. That on the left, you see a render that I did in Autodesk Inventor. The holes are slightly larger than the snaps, so it's an easy fit and it wouldn't be too much pressure and it wouldn't have the issue of breaking. And on the right side, you see two physical pictures of the snaps working. Then I reached my few final obstacles. It was a lot of logistic stuff, like adding the correct amount of support material onto the top of the tool, because since they printed separately, it was very difficult for this piece to print without it like falling over. So I need to add a lot of support material. As you can see, the base where the triangular prism reaches the bottom is slightly slanted because it started to fall over during the printing process. Finally, I was able to get all of those errors out of the way. And I was able to render my final process. On the left, you see the base. It goes to a kind of rounded tip because in self-defense, a rounded tip is actually better because it does more immediate damage and causes the attacker to not want to continue rather than just a quick puncture or something. And on the right, you have the hook, which is used to open doors and all things that you could need. And this is the final project, fully put together. This is a render of it, and then this is it in person. So the proper usage would be to hold it with the hook facing forward so you could open a door, what have you. and then have the tip towards the bottom in case you need it. This is it working on a door. It's a close-up image, but it does work, I can assure you. Thank you, and I actually have the piece that I need right there.
It's not particularly interesting. It's just kind of adhered and snapped together. This could be used to drag things across tables, get to the edge. And then this is the self-defense portion.
Up next, I would like to introduce my classmate, Jeremy Sanchez.
All right. Hello, everybody. My name is Jeremy Sanchez. I just want to start by saying thank you to everybody that attended today in person or on Zoom. Doesn't matter. Thank you for coming. I want to say thank you to all my teachers and staff and everyone in the STEM Academy for supporting me my 4 years and for bringing us through this chaotic year. And I think we all can agree that it was pretty okay. So my final capstone project, nothing runs like a deer. You're going to find out what that means in a minute. So identifying the problem, in the beginning of the year, we all had to pick a bunch of problems that we wanted to solve and do a little bit of research, and then eventually narrow it down to four things. And if you know me, I like cars a lot. And so obviously my first two main problems were car sound and horsepower and white letter tires, meaning just to go over quickly, the car sound and horsepower is for my newer Challenger, has a Hemi in it. Doesn't sound the same based on the way the engine runs, but I abandoned that because I don't feel like opening up a brand new car engine that runs perfectly fine. It's not practical. So white letter tires is also out because they already made a white letter tire kit for newer cars. Recording your own records was another idea that I had because I collect vinyl records. I'm very old school, if you can't tell already. Vinyl records is something I listen to on a daily, and I can't make playlists. I have to go through the entire record to listen to just the one song I want to listen to. So an MP3 type deal was the idea there, but I abandoned it because, well, I'd rather work on the one that I chose. So the one that I chose was going with garden tractors. Aside from cars, my side hobby is fixing tractors, especially old tractors. Now, what is a garden tractor? Well, garden tractors typically get confused with lawn tractors. Lawn tractors are used mainly only to cut grass because they're driven with a belt pulley system, and they're very weak. They can't pull very much. They're not very heavy duty. A garden tractor is a very heavy duty tractor that's a hydraulic driven system directly from the engine through drive shaft to the rear end. And the way that works is, well, it's all hydraulic. And to put into perspective, a typical garden tractor weighs 700 pounds and a lawnmower weighs 300. So it's about double the weight, and it's a huge difference. Here's a picture of my two lawnmowers, or garden tractor and lawnmower. On the left is my John Deere 317. It's a 1979, so this is a 700-pound machine on the dot. The one on the right is a 2001 John Deere Sabre lawnmower. It's only 300 pounds, so you can tell just by looking at it how much beefier the garden tractor really is. Why John Deere? I figured I should say this. John Deere has been in business since 1839 when blacksmith John Deere came up with his first self-scoring steel plow. And ever since then, it's been a household name in the farming industry. As most people know, when you see a green and yellow tractor, it's a John Deere. I just picked it because I like American products. My dad grew up on a farm in Brazil, and he always tells me about the John Deeres that they had back then. And they all, the old stuff really runs well. So that's also why I picked the old machines. Here's some other tractor brands just for reference, just so you know, John Deere wasn't the only one around back in the day. So my idea, I'm a landscaper. I work with my friend's father as a landscaper. And during the fall, trees drop a lot of leaves, and it's always a pain in the butt to clean up. So we have these things called walk-behind blowers. And for massive parking lots, me being me, I enjoy doing it. But most people don't like having to go across parking lots back and forth with this machine, having to carry it up hills and all of that. So my idea was to convert it to run on the front of my John Deere 317. And to make it work as a blower, an idea I also had was to make it a vacuum, but I wound up dumping that idea based on the way the bracketry worked. So here are my first sketches. This is when I still had it as the vacuum idea, but really the idea here in these sketches was to show off my bracketry idea. So the top left is my John Deere 300 series. There's a 316, 317, 318. So the bracket has a bottom bracket for the mule drive, it's called. That's what runs the mower deck. And I have it connect to that. And that's basically the same throughout the three drawings for the John Deere, and then Cub Cadet and Case also were two major brands. That's why I chose them too. My next set of sketches was the first top left. Mr. Locatel challenged me to figure out how to get the tractor to cut grass as well as clean it up. So I put a reel mower, it's called, on the front. And those are the ones that you see that you just push and it's self-propelled. And I wound up, while I dumped the vacuum head design, I was able to run the mule drive at the same time with the deck. So I was able to blow and cut at the same time. The top right one is a rear mount design. So I could also run the mowing deck, but suck things up at the same time. And the bottom left is the idea that I went with, is just keeping it a blower. Here's my final drawing. And it's just my John Deere with the blower on the front. This is my first render that I drew in Inventor. And I made it look as real as possible. It's pretty two scale. And of course I got rid of the vacuum head. This is a different view. You can see the bracket that I came up with. And I later added, because this isn't very well supported the way it sits, especially with that vacuum head on it, and that that blower attachment weighs maybe 50 pounds, 60 pounds in itself, so it's probably going to fall off. So I wound up getting rid of that vacuum head and putting caster wheels, because the mowers we have at work are zero turn mowers and they have three sets of wheels. The front holds the deck and they spin with the back, so it follows it. So that's the design that I wound up going with. This is the other view. So the first thing that I had to do was restore the tractor, because I like buying garbage. I don't know why, but I always do. And I like to fix it. So I bought this for $500 a few years ago. I took it apart. I wound up buying cars because then I got my license, and then it got pushed to the back burner, stayed in the corner of my backyard for a few years. And then I wound up going back to it now, because now I needed it for the project. So I don't have the pictures on here. I made a video of the entire building process, because I have videos of me making the blower attachment, welding, cutting, and all those things. So I'll also include in the video is the blower attachment operating and how I built that, how I designed it. This is the other side of the John Deere. You can see it's in pretty rough shape, but for its age, 1979, it's in pretty decent shape. So now I'm going to switch over to the video. I'm going to hit the sound. Where's Mr. Lock? Hang on. I'm
Pays the thrills, the bills, the bills.